Hi, everyone. I want to welcome an incredible guest today that I have been waiting for. I'm so excited about this. This is Mike Paterson from Sasquatch, Ontario, and he's going to talk about the incredible experiences and research that he has been doing for years. And it's fascinating. And we're just going to go delve deep into the world of Sasquatch in
Hey, Lauda.
Ontario.
Thanks for having me on. All good.
It's fantastic. I can't wait. So how did this all start?
I was spending time in the woods. This would be back like in 2007, 2007, I think. And I was in the woods on my time off photographing wildlife, just a hobby, right? Serious hobby. I went out, bought some good camera gear, taught myself photography, and just would spend time in nature by myself. And I'm pretty sure I was being watched. And one day I just had this epiphany just come out of nowhere to start looking for Sasquatch. You know, just this, I don't know where it came from. I at this point I think they had something to do with that because of what I've learned, what they're capable of. But so I did. And then the very first three times I went out looking for them, stuff happened. So the very first time was up by Bon Echo region in Ontario. You know, it's just all woods up there, and I went camping with a buddy of mine, and we heard one vocalizing off in the distance in the morning. It was just kind of screaming over and over, and I remember I found a video that basically matched that. These guys doing this camp, they were camping, they were breaking down their camp in the morning, and you know, it was basically verbatim. It was the same thing. And then the second time was my close vocal encounter, and that was in October 2008. So I can't remember, maybe it could have been in 2008 too when I did the camping thing, but the photography, yeah, I started that. I think it was about 07, and yeah, I started looking into it, and then stuff happened right away, like immediately.
Do you think they put it in you? Do you think
Yeah.
that they invited you to like make contact and that's why it suddenly occurred to you like, wow, I'm gonna look for Sasquatch?
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned, I at this point I think they had something to do with that
Yeah.
for sure.
And when you heard the screaming the first time, did it scare you?
No, it was off in the distance.
Yeah.
No, just I was with a good buddy of mine, and we just stood there listening, and you know, kind of wow, you know, what's that? And there was no fear. And then the second time, that's the time that changed my life. You know, that's when I was talking to you just before we went on here, and that happened in a very odd location that I never would have dreamed of in a million years, really. You know, when I first got involved, I used to think, I think most people think that you got to go to the West Coast to you know, where you are to possibly witness anything, right? I had no idea they were here in Ontario.
I didn't either. I had no idea. So what made that situation so unbelievably surprising?
It was like three just massive guttural, really raspy whoops. And when it happened, a guy I was with at the time, you know, he was kind of showing me the ropes. He'd picked up a fist-sized rock. It was October 25th, 2008. It's about 4:30 in the afternoon when it happened. It was overcast, slight drizzle going on, and this patch of woods, I think it is a couple hundred hectares, and you know, it's bordered by residential. You know, like that was the first time I'd ever been there. You know, that's the first time I met him too, and I met him in the parking lot at like noon, and it was you know, banging on trees, doing that stuff, kind of showing me the ropes. I had no idea. You know, I kept an open mind. And as I mentioned, he picked up a fist-sized rock at one point, went up and smacked a tree, I think three, four times, dropped the rock. And then suddenly these whoops, these massive guttural whoops happened. And they were so loud, they just filled the woods. It was, you know, we were on a main trail, kind of a crossroad at a main trail, and people walk their dogs through there. They horseback ride through there. And I knew what it was instantly, but you know, my mind was just, I was in shock, right? Shocked me. There was no fear. Yeah. And I remember this lady come walking around the corner, and she was walking her dog, and she had this scowl on her face. And we just kind of nodded, said hi as she walked by. She was closer than we were, but you know, she heard it loud and clear, right? Mm-hmm. And that put me, you know, on this path. And and it was the week after, actually, I went back by myself into the same area, and then I went up the road a little bit. There's another patch of woods there, probably about the same size, and you know, concession size, right? Bordered by concessions on all four sides. And then that's where I had my first bout of high strangeness. So that was, you know, that was brought on real quick. And I had, I remember when the first incident happened, when he smacked the tree, there was like a triple chest thump sound, like a hollow, like when a silverback gorilla beats its chest, you know, it was the same sound, pretty close, right? And I recognized that this was really odd, and that was immediately before the call. So when I went back the next week, I heard that exact same triple chest thump tone right beside me in this stand of trees. And I was alone, and I had binoculars, camera, video, all that. I had everything on me. And like I said, this is when I had my first bout of high strangeness. So I ended up, I was driving in my car on my way home, and not realizing I didn't remember leaving the woods. You know, I'm driving, it's like, how the hell did I get here? I just kind of shook my head. It's like, what the hell's going on? And that was wild.
What do you think happened there?
Oh, well, they sent me away. There was no fear, but they sent me away.
Mm-hmm. Incredible.
You know, at that time, I was out for picture of a lifetime, right? You know,
mm-hmm. My
motives have changed since, obviously, but I had no idea what I was dealing with. And
well, that's an area you would never expect to have an encounter.
No.
You expect to go in the woods, and it's true. A lot of people think, you know, you have to go to the West Coast, and it. But that area, like, that's phenomenal to me.
It's he took me there because there was previous activity in that region, right? There had been reports. The reports had been kept quiet, though. You know, the BFRO had the information, and I'm not very.
I wonder what was drawing them there. Like, why would they come so close?
Well, there, you know, there's
curious,
good sized patch of woods.
Mm-hmm.
They live there, right?
Yeah,
they live there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's deer there. There's wolves in there, and you know, there's all kinds of wildlife in there.
And you so know. You went from there, and then what happened?
Oh, I spent the next 4 years going back.
Yeah,
every weekend as much as I could for the first year. I think the second year, you know, slowed down a little bit, but I just kept going back for 4 years. Having numerous incidents happen. I remember I pulled in there one morning. It was a parking lot, right? And I got there early, and you know, it was light out. There was nobody, no cars in the parking lot. So I walk in, and I'm down this trail a bit, you know, maybe a couple hundred yards in from the parking lot, and I hear this vehicle come in, you know, and then it was like seconds or very, very shortly after that, I get this woo, you know, really close to me. And my first thought was, how the hell did they get in here so quick, you know?
Yeah.
And then I heard a response maybe 100 yards ahead from another one. And I remember looking, because it was right there beside me, really close. And that's when I realized, when I heard the other one, it's like, oh, okay, that's you guys, right? Yeah. So I knew that was two Sasquatch calling back to each other. And they were giving away, you know, that they were there.
Yeah.
And I used to go in there and do this wood knock, like bang, bang, a short pause, and another bang. My signature wood knock to announce my presence when I go in there. And I remember I pull in parking lot one day. There's a bunch of cars in that. And I get out to, I walk around my vehicle to grab my equipment. And I suddenly hear really loud and clear too, my wood knocks that I always do for them. And I just like, what the hell do they, you know, they know I'm here. I still, you know, I had no clue what they were capable of at this point. Right. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I was in there another night, with this same guy that, showed me the ropes, basically. His name was Mike too. And, it was snow on the ground. It was like, I think it was like full moon or close to it, a lot of light. And it was really late, middle of the night during the week. And we come across this trackway that was crossing this main trail, you know, in the snow. So I was looking at it, trying to figure out what it was. It was a deer hopping through the snow or what. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly we hear clear as day right there, bipedal footsteps walking through the snow, right? You know, right there. And there was nothing there. So I was freaking out. And so that was another high strangeness incident. And so I spent a lot of time in those woods, basically learning. And I think I was, they were waiting till I had enough experience. And then that's when a situation got basically dropped into my lap. And when the information came, it's really strange. I had a knowing. Mm-hmm. Like I had a knowing, this is it. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm waiting for. And which also showed me that, you know, there was purpose behind this, or, mm-hmm. you know, this was meant to be, right? And sure enough, you know, 10 years later now, still going there, interacting with the same family.
That's incredible. I think what you've brought to light is so, there's so much to me that is phenomenal about this, because you actually also communicate through writing with them.
Yeah, I developed written communication. It first started with about this whiteboard, you know, race is easy, mm-hmm. and stuck it up in the woods. I drew a Sasquatch and a stick man. I can't draw where the... this really lousy drawing. Put it up in the woods. And when I went to, you know, left the marker with it. When I went to collect it, they had drawn on it. They had drawn this squiggly line connecting the two. And I think there was a couple other things drawn there. I can't remember. I have a picture of it in my computer somewhere. But yeah, they connected the two. And then I... That move to outside the cottage, you know, with a little paper notepad and a crayon.
Yeah.
And I'd drawn something, you know, wrote friend. I drew this little glyph thing. And I remember they marked it, you know, they also marked that. So that was, it was after that. I can't remember how long after, but, probably years, mm-hmm. that I ended up buying a chalkboard and a sketch pad, and things moved in indoors. And I at this point I gift indoors now too. So
you gift indoors?
Oh yeah, the gifting is done indoors. They've even gone right into my bag and pulled stuff out before I've even, you know, put it out on the counter. Well yeah, there's it's a lot of the activity, a lot of it is indoors.
Oh, okay, Mike, that's blowing my mind.
Vocals, you know, I record lots of vocals inside.
So they're coming into your home.
It's not here.
Or the cottage.
Yeah, I have had visits here. Mm-hmm. Where we go, that's basically their home base, right? So when the property owner and I are together, he gets his activity when he's by himself, and I get mine when I'm by myself. But when mm-hmm. the two of us are together, mm-hmm. it's crazy. It's been on 100% of the visits since day one, over 10 years. And it's developed at this point. It's natural. We're there. They're with us, you know, can't see them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They're with us.
So how are they getting in?
Oh, they're interdimensional.
Right. Okay. Let's talk about that.
Yeah. I'm even getting my foot grabbed underneath the table, you know, stuff like that. They're funny, right? There's a lot of humor with this. The apports, like the, oh, I can't reach that. A lot of marbles, right? So there's written communication that's been developed. I'll ask questions. Mm-hmm. I just talk out loud because I know they're listening. Mm-hmm. And I'll write a question down as well. They don't answer everything, but the questions were, at first, you know, got a bit confusing. I was all excited, you know, they're not giving these big detailed answers, or I'd write a few questions and then I wouldn't understand what answer was for what. And so I've changed my questioning to basically yes or no answers for the most part, right? Mm-hmm. For the most part, not all of it, which is working quite well.
And they answer with English, like they write words.
Yeah, they've answered with in English and other language. They've even written down the language that I tried finding something on it. I don't know what it is. They wrote it on the chalkboard. And then I remember it's funny because somebody posted something today, and I had actually posted these two shots today. Mm-hmm. So it was chalkboard, and they wrote down, because I'd asked, what language do you speak? And they wrote this name down, looked English, but it's not. I think they probably have a different name for it than we would. Mm-hmm. And then I remember sitting there at the table trying to pronounce it properly. And then we went outside. And when it came back in, it had been revised because they were showing, you know, no, you're not saying it properly. And then they wrote with that, they wrote in English, speak here, and they put an arrow, basically, we speak this language here. And it was pretty wild.
Wow. So what was the name of the language that they said, do you know?
It looks like it said like a GLEPIN and then a dash and an O.
Okay.
But I haven't a clue. I've tried looking that word up. I don't find anything.
That is fascinating. So you spent years discovering their abilities.
Well, they started when this first started up, mm-hmm. way back in the beginning. Girlfriends would be with us and the dogs and sometimes Dwayne's dad, who, you know, he passed quite a while back, but he was with us for a lot of visits doing his own thing. And I remember when the marbles started appearing and the activity started happening indoors, we tried to, you know, do our best to keep it from him, right? Mm-hmm. Until we weren't there and he was by himself and it was still happening. So, you know, he'd be getting marbles and we weren't there, right? So, what's that?
Why do they like marbles? And sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, that's okay. I don't know. It's just been an item that has been really predominant throughout. It's something easy for them, mm-hmm. but it's not just this situation either. It's something that's become quite common with a lot of researchers, and actually a researcher friend of mine, Leanne, mm-hmm. I talked to her the other day and she just had a marble incident at home. It was her first, you know, she was on the couch doing some work, immersed in her work, you know, she's in the room by herself and she ended up hearing a marble hit the floor or hit the table, and it ended up on the floor. It was a fair size clear marble. It just out of thin air, right? So that was her first. I was glad that she really, got to experience that. And I had an incident also with her a few years back where I had left some marbles in my camp spot, a place where I go to put my tent by my, you know, I was by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember there's these two big clear blue marbles. And I even have, video footage of myself leaving them there, and I hold them up and like, oh, this is a nice one. I was going to keep them because they were so nice.
Yeah.
And I thought, no, I'm going to leave them as a gift. And I think because of that, because of what I did there, mm-hmm. They disappeared, those two marbles. When I went back days later, they were gone. Mm-hmm. And Leanne ended up telling me that she found these two big blue marbles, just like the ones I had left. And she gifted marbles at her cottage, which was hours away from where I am. She's never even, been to where I am, so she doesn't even know where it is. And she found these two blue marbles. She goes, I've never put these out. And I said, take a picture and show me. And I freaked out. I said, holy smokes, those are like, I didn't say smokes. They ended up being just like the ones that I found. So I'm quite sure that, there was a connection there, right? And so when I saw her in person, she gave them back to me. Obviously, I gave her one.
Mm-hmm,
So we
mm-hmm.
both got one of those. And so, yeah, marbles have been, so it's not just marbles, though. It's a lot of other stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And they don't like to be caught doing it. It's something that you turn your head for a second and boom, something happens. Or they like the element of surprise.
Mm-hmm.
I got a can of beer in front of me. I turn my head for a second, look, turn back, and there's a marble sitting on top of it. Stuff like that, right? But they did allow me to see two times. I think it was two visits in a row. The moment that it enters this realm from another dimension, they allowed me to see that. I was sitting at a table the first time it happened. Window was open. I had audio running outside, so it caught the sound of the marble hitting the floor. Was it the floor or the table? I can't remember. And I think it was the floor. And then me freaking out, right? So I turned my head. I'm sitting at the table. They knew where my gaze was, and it happened at about arm's length. And I see this marble start to appear, just, like right in midair. And it got bigger, like it was being pushed through a wormhole. And then it popped into this dimension and hit the floor. So I got to watch the whole scenario. And then the next visit, they did it again. But I was actually bent over putting on my boots or shoes or whatever it was. And it happened in that space, looking down. So they did it right there. So yeah, that was wild. Dwayne hasn't witnessed that yet. I keep asking for it. I figure at some point, hopefully they'll show him.
But, they have a real sense of humor, right?
Oh, that's constant. And
yeah.
Neff, we used to call him Mr. Funny before we got his name.
Yeah.
And so there's a younger male family member that is very much involved at this point. His name's Ninyanen. I think he's a young teenager, and he's a lot more rambunctious than Neff was. He's doing some stuff that, can almost piss you off sometimes, but there's never any malevolence to it, right?
Like what?
Oh, this was some of the stuff he does. I sit on this cushion on this chair. It's got all these divots in it. He fills them up with water. So I sit down, get a wet ass. He does that a lot, actually. So many times, but I'm catching on, right? I remember get this potato covered in all this cream stuff shoved in my shoe, or but this was really alarming. One time, I've learned they know if you have any disease, right? So I don't need to go to a doctor. I just ask them. And so I was asked, I asked them one visit not long ago, you know, do I have any, do I have cancer parasites? And I get yes, to both, right? And I tell Dwayne, I'm like, you know, I'm kind of, it's surreal, so I'm kind of calm about it. And then I asked where, and they had written brain and drew this little brain, right? So at this point, you know, Dwayne's outside, I stick my head out the door. I had brain cancer apparently, right? And and so I'm kind of a little, you know, like, what the hell's going on here? So I found out that was Ninyanan, just trying to be funny, because I got three more times from after that, Mike, no see. They were really adamant. Mike, don't worry, you know, like, you don't have cancer. Because they said for the first time, no. And you know, I'm trying to get this completely confirmed, right? So yeah. They ended up three times, like, no, 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 you don't, right? And then I'd asked after, you know, was that Ninyan? And they wrote, ha, ha.
Oh, muffin.
I thought, well, shit, dude, that's not very funny.
Funny at all.
No,
oh, my God.
Yeah, you know, I take marbles off the head sometimes. You know, they're not trying to hurt me, but it's last visit. I think it was last visit. I took a good-sized marble, you know, coming, I come out the door, going down the stairs, right off the back of my skull by my ear. And you can, I have an audio recorder, maybe 30, 40 feet away. You actually hear it hit my skull, right? And then it, after that though, I basically, I'm standing on the road. I basically got hugged from behind, on my head, like a half a hug, you know, like a good grip on my head, like, just hug me and then let go, right? I'd asked for it earlier that yeah. night too. So there's a lot of physical contact, which, you know, has proven their invisibility to me, right? And it happens both indoors and out. And it's pretty much every visit, you know, the physical contact at this point, right? So it's very well developed. You know, we both get it, the physical contact. And the vocals indoors, you know, everything that happens outside happens indoors pretty much, except for footprints in the snow, obviously.
Right.
Last visit when I showed up, I'd bring in my, there's snow on the ground, I'm bringing my stuff from my vehicle. The first thing I do, I get out, you know, Dwayne's already in, indoors. And first thing I do is I look for footprints, right?
Yeah.
You know, see if they, because they do, you know, I'll get there and there's a gift waiting, you know, there's a footprint, a single print or more. Or, so there was nothing. So I'm walking up the path to the stairs, go up to the front door, and I hear a wood knock as I'm walking up the stairs from close by, just a single, it wasn't really loud, but it was clear. Right. So I put my stuff in, hey Dwayne, you know, I just heard a wood knock coming up the stairs. And talking for a second, and then I go back out the door to get more stuff. And before I even go down the steps, I can see at the bottom on the left side, there's 10 footprints circling a tree that just appeared seconds earlier. And so they gave, you know, that was the wood knock. And then they give me the, it was 10 prints. And we got, it took some really good footage of that. And, you know, and there's hair in the prints, and they weren't nefs, they were much, they were closer to my size, maybe a little wider and, you know, slightly bigger, but young family member, don't know who it's from, but this is common, right? I had asked for a to see an adult print that night, and we got one, we got a single, and we think it might have been from the mother because we didn't really recognize it. But this was like really late, so I was tired, you know, got a few beers in this, and I didn't even run in and grab the tape measure. I just took some photos with my my phone, and it was probably close to 20 inches, you know, just one print. But it wasn't wide like the big guys who we've seen, who has a 20, 21-inch print now, I think. because I think his print was about 8 inches wide. This one was, you know, nowhere near that. But
So have you met the whole family, and how tall are they?
I have no idea how many are in the family. We've gotten, I think, 10 names from them at this point. Some of them, you know, I don't even really know how to pronounce them properly, but...
Can you try?
Well, the mother, they wrote Omra, O-M-R-A. There's Neff, there's Neftia, there's Ninyanin. There's one of them's called Mushka. Anastasia, Ashantia. There's one I asked one day who's doing the writing, and she wrote like Bergiette, something like that. There was another one that it was spelt like P-O-R-G-I, Porgy, something like that. And another one was like Ugrath, something like that.
They're amazing names.
Yeah, you know, it's just all kinds of differences in the names anyways. And
do you have any idea how tall they are?
Well, the big guy was photographed back in 2013, February 9th, I believe it was 2013. Dwayne and I were on another part of the property, and he had shown himself to you know, Dwayne's spouse while we were out, and she was in the cottage, right? So she saw him through the cottage window. He was maybe a couple hundred feet away, maybe, I don't know, maybe 100 yards or so, somewhere in that range. And so she took a shot through the window, but it sadly latched onto the screen. So he's a bit difficult to make out, although you can see him, right? You know, he's bent at the knees, his big, big upper torso and like shorter legs. But I remember at the time I said, let's not go up there to look at any prints, just out of respect, right? And it was the next week when we went back, I recreated the shot. So I went and stood in the same spot, and we photographed through the window. The only difference, I had a much better camera, you know, quality lens, and I put it up to the screen so it shoots through, right? Tried to line it up as best I could. So it puts him at roughly 12 feet tall. Neff, I'm not sure. Maybe he's, you know, I don't know how tall he is at this point. At least 8 feet, you know. When he was photographed, it was back in 2019, December, late December 2019, close to midnight. I think it was about 11:40 and 11:41 p.m. There was two photos taken. The fence is only 66 inches, 5.5 feet. So he's basically a head above that. Big, I think a big head above that, and his arms leaning on top. And when Dwayne had stepped outside, he didn't see him. He heard a giggle, like a child's laughter. So we've been doing this well. So he pointed his phone, took a shot, didn't hear the shutter sound go off in his phone. So he took a second shot a few seconds later, and which I'm glad he did, because it shows clear facial differences, right? Especially around his mouth area. You know, obviously taken a lot of flack over those photographs, right? Anybody who wants to see them, you know, go to my channel. There's I did three videos on those, and you know, the photos are, they're crystal clear, right?
Yeah, they are.
And so, which makes it difficult for people to believe it, right? It's too too good for, just like the vocals were when I first started putting them out. You know, they're crystal clear. You know, it's all real. So when Dwayne took those, you know, it was at a distance. He didn't see him. You know, he quickly looks at his phone, doesn't really see anything. And then when he went inside, he zoomed right in, and that's when he got on the phone to me. And yeah, he was pretty shocked. And
so they're more comfortable now with you taking photographs, but it's not often.
No, it's fine that I take photos. I take photos all the time. It's, you know, when they leave prints, I'm out there documenting. I'm getting marbles thrown at me. Prints appearing beside me in real time as I'm documenting, right? They haven't done it on camera yet.
Yeah.
But last winter, you know, we went outside at one point. It's, you know, it's in the dark, and we're scanning for prints, you know, and come at the cottage and we're looking, right? We're not in the woods. We're surrounded by woods, but we don't have to go into the woods. This is all always out in the open, right?
Right.
So there's no prints. And it's like, okay, let's go back indoors. And just before we leave, I said, hold on, just I'm going to take one more quick look. And suddenly, boom, there's a footprint, right? Just happened. And then, so I'm documenting that. And then suddenly there's, I think it was three or four others from, I think there was three different family members that suddenly left footprints right beside us while we're documenting. I got a couple marbles hitting me in the side. And, you know, they're right there with us. They're always right there with us.
I think you needed to ask them permission, though, before you release the pictures. So what I'm, I think what I'm referring to is that, like, you have, like, you're being very careful with what's presented to the world. And I think you can talk about that.
When the pictures happened, it was the next visit. I had asked them, and I used the chalkboard and asked them, do you want these pictures put in a video for the world to see? And they wrote, not yet. So I thought, oh, that was a surprising answer. I thought they would say no. They wrote not yet, so I dropped it. And then I can't remember how long after that, might have been even years or a year, or they can manipulate all of our electronics, cameras, video cameras, phones, computer, anything. I've had them all manipulated by them. And it's happened, you know, on location in front of us. Like some of the stuff I don't even say because it's too much, and listen to what I already say, right?
Well, feel free to do that. Everybody that listens here, they are, you know, they
know how to use these things. And I'm talking like my phone's been hijacked and I've had some explaining to do because some rude texts have been sent, you know, in the middle of the night to several people. That's Ninyana.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he wrote fag to my dad. And I had I told him, I said, some redneck got hold of my phone last night. Sorry. You know, he goes, no, don't worry. No damage done. I couldn't tell him.
What a brat.
He's constant. Trust me. He's constant. He's also, you know, I've basically become a drug dealer for family Sasquatch. He loves magic mushrooms, right? Where is it?
Oh my God, this is.
Oh yeah, I've given him about 25 grams so far, and I got this for him for. I'll give him that in a couple visits. You know, all the mushrooms I get now, they're all for him, right?
What a character!
Oh, he's the first time I found out was. Actually, I digress. Let me get back to that part first. So they know how to manipulate our electronics. So I had asked about the photos. They wrote not yet. And then at one point I use this point and shoot camera that I bought for them to play with. I leave it on the table, you know, with the other stuff. And I've gotten literally dozens of images over the years from them. And some of them have appeared in real time as I'm sitting there and the camera's not left my sight. One of the images that appeared was a close-up of Neff's face, which I believe was from the same images that Dwayne took. So they, you know, it's mind-boggling what they can do, right? So I had asked at that time, it was a bit blurry and close-up. So I thought, oh, maybe they're giving me this to put in. And I'd asked, oh, can I share this? And they wrote no. So I was, okay, and I left it. And then it happened again. More recently, they did the same thing with the close-up. And that was the Neff selfie. And I got his footprint when I showed up that visit as well, within 15 minutes of arrival. It was the last snow of the year, last chance, and he gave it to me. And then that night I got that selfie. And that's when I asked again, you know, oh, can I put, you know, is this... you know, is this okay to share? And they wrote yes. And I was like, holy shit, I didn't expect that. So I did, and that's when I did that selfie video. And then it was shortly after that I was given the message, Mike, you show. And that's th so almost 3.5 years later, put those photographs in. So I didn't ask. I'd only asked 3.5 years ago. So it was, they told me, Mike, you show. And that was it. And you know, we're both, Dwayne and I are like, holy shit. You know, here we go, right? Because I knew here comes a shit show putting these out. You know, they want them out, so it's like, okay, let's do it. And you know, sure enough, every day I'm blocking, you know, masks, 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 and people, you know, yeah, okay, well, find me those masks, prove it. You'll never find. And there's different facial expressions, right? So yeah, you know, people obviously, I get ridiculed and people rip
Yeah.
that apart, but no, that
Well, because they
one
haven't
day.
had anything supernatural in their lives, right? Because when you do, you realize it's, and this is the hard thing dealing here and trying to expose the truth. You're always coming up against those that have never experienced anything. So I look at those photos. There's no way I would ever think mask ever. I don't even understand it, but so they want us to know. They want people to know about them.
We are in the midst of them exposing their existence to us, to those they select. You know, you get these people, like I said, and they get nothing. So they know their intention. They know our, I'm pretty convinced they know our thoughts. They can read us, you know. I've been given experiences where I have felt their emotions, you know, from a little one that they brought to meet me in a dream state, you know, contact dream state, right? It's yeah, that was back in 2013. There was an older female in my peripheral, you know, couldn't see her. I'd sleep on the couch, and I'm exactly the same in the dream. And this older female brings one of the kids to me, 3, 4 year old, you know, little girl. I thought it was a little boy at first, way back, but I'm pretty sure it was a little one of the little girls. And she stood in front of me, and I remember I reached my hand out, and she took my hand. So I'm sitting there holding onto her hand, and I feel her emotions run, you know, running through me, and she's freaked right out, but she's so excited. And I was conscious enough in that state to give my hand just a little, you know, a little jerk to purposely get a reaction from her, not to scare her, you know. And I'm conscious enough in that state doing this, right? Which in itself was mind blowing. But when I did that, it was like an explosion of her emotions, you know, right up through me. And she didn't let go. And then, you know, and then it dissolved shortly after that. And I woke up and I was like, wow. And I, you know, again on the phone to Dwayne. Yeah, it showed me how they feel. It was
Incredible.
pretty intense, pretty incredible. Yeah. So.
So it would sound like they have a lot more feeling than what we usually do.
Oh, night and day. They are so connected to energy, the fabric of reality. You know, they are masters of energy. They have mastered consciousness. They can command our consciousness. You know, they can take over our consciousness.
Have you had
It's
that happen?
with their contact dreams, you know, it shows that. But there's been other stuff happen as well that I'm not, I can't talk about, that you know, involves consciousness. You know, and I've learned things too that, you know, we know how to disappear, or we can disappear like they can. You know, they've told us this, and you know, so they are, you know, they're teachers, and they're very efficient teachers. They give a lot of information with, you know, very small gestures, right? Oh, you're invisible. Now I know you're invisible. You know, you're in the cottage, you're in my car. Oh, okay. Now I know there's no walls with you guys. You're in my vehicle. I've captured a vocalization in my vehicle on my dash cam. It's that was I'm quite sure that was Ninyan. Dwayne and I in the vehicle driving down the back roads and a couple times now, and there's been activity happen in the car. There's been activity happen in my vehicle with us in there a couple times. And it's by myself and also with another witness present, so that's happened. And it's also showed up in a workplace. And and the whole smell thing too, I have the answer to that as well. So they've given me a lot, so much experience and information, right? The smells I've learned, they create them. They create different smells. They can recreate smells. And I'm talking stuff like black ash or a vape pen or a wood smell or perfume or just all kinds of stuff. They can recreate and they can direct it individually and right up your freaking nostril if they want. I've had Ninyanen, so I've had manure and dog feces, dog shit smell put right up my nostril. Dwayne's sitting right there, he can't smell anything, and then they did it to him. Right? That's all Ninyanen, right? Practicing his skills on.
What a trickster.
Oh, we're the guinea pigs. That dude, man, I tell you. I've called him an asshole a couple of times. Yeah.
Ever talked to you about the different species? Do
No,
they
I've
ever talk? No.
never. Sorry. I've never had a conversation, like, except for the verbal stuff that I've put out publicly. I've never been able to have a back and forth fluent conversation with them.
And
They
telepathy?
I've had telepathic incidents, as well as Dwayne,
Right.
and but it's very abrupt.
Okay. So you don't get downloads of information about their history or their
No, I haven't.
origin, or what do you think their origin is?
I asked them that. I haven't gotten an answer yet, except I asked them about I said I wrote, "Who created humans?" And I got no response. And I changed my question. I said, "Did the Anunnaki create humans?" And they said, "Yes." And then I asked, "Do we have the same creator, like them and us?" And they said, "No." So I've had
Interesting.
I'm just this is what I'm told, right? So I've learned they hold honesty in high regard. So certain things are done in humor, like the cancer crap stuff
Yes.
Indiana did, but when it comes to other certain questions,
Yes.
I'm quite confident they're telling the truth, right?
And what's the usual radius that they travel?
I have no idea, but I think that they can show up like that. I think that they can. Because I remember one night, like I got woods behind me here, and it's tends to be pretty quiet back there. I put audio back there sometimes to get activity, and they show their presence here. I don't know if it's Neff's family. I think it's another family, but I think Neff has shown up here. And I remember one night, I'm on texting back and forth with Dwayne, and stuff starts happening. Get weird stuff going on. We know we're being listened to. And I say, "Hey, tell Neff to, come and say hi." So I walk out the back door. It's midnight, and I think I got about 30 steps, and it sounded maybe a couple hundred yards in the woods, but I got two good solid wood knocks. Just walked out the back door through the coincidence of that. That's never happened before, not like that, and I just asked for that. And so that was like, that's like that, traveling like that, right? Maybe they can project their consciousness and I don't know. I don't have the answers, right?
Yeah. What do you know what the whoop sounds mean?
No.
No. Yeah,
no
I've always wondered.
No. I think like wood knock stuff, and I don't think they're banging trees. Maybe they are sometimes. I don't know, but I've been asleep on the couch.
Yeah.
On location, you know, have dinner, take a short nap. So we're up all night. And I've woken up at one time. As soon as I open my eyes, I get this telepathic, loud and clear wood knock. You know, and just or we pulled up to this spot in a snowmobile once. There's nobody around. There's no snowmobiles going. There's, you know, it's quiet. Dwayne kills the snowmobile. And then suddenly from close by, we hear two revs from a snowmobile engine. No motor running. That was it, right? So I think they can, as they can recreate and create smells, I think they can do the same with sounds.
Right. Have you ever had exposure to a different type of species of Sasquatch?
Not that I'm aware of. Remember, I was in California, Mendocino, with a friend of mine, Sonia. This is, I don't know, maybe way back in 2015. And, you know, we went into this area for the night. And I remember I got a telepathic snarl that did not sound Sasquatch, but it sounded, it was crazy. And I had audio running outside the tent. I remember I wasn't even afraid. It woke me up. And I thought, oh, that's going to be on the recorder. And there was nothing there. So, and I remember the clarity of it. It was crystal clear. So I realized, no, that was telepathic. Something was, I don't know if it didn't like us being there, but it, that was wild.
Did you get a feeling of what it was?
No, but it was.
Ooh, scary.
Very. Yeah, but it's weird. I wasn't scared.
Yeah.
But it was very scary sounding. I wish I could have had that on audio, because it was crazy scary sounding. I remember, we went by this river, and I found this line of this, you know, short trackway, small prints. I actually tell this story on the last interview that, or the last video I posted, with it says eyewitness account with Sonia Zohar. And so when we were there, we went by this river, and I'm looking at these prints, and they're in a tightrope walk, you know. So I was convinced they were Sasquatch, and that's when we left there. We went to the Mendocino. Then when we came back, we stopped at that spot again the next day, and there was a, I don't know, 4 foot length of stick, tree limb, you know, maybe a couple inches in diameter, a few inches in diameter. And it had been moved to the other side of the tracks, the trackway. So saying that, and that's what Sasquatch would do, you know, picking it up and basically showing their presence, right? You know, you're not going to, it's some human there. We didn't see any there when we were there both times. They do things like that. When we were coming out of Mendocino, at one point, you know, it's kind of going up this incline. We stop, get out of the vehicle, and we're, I don't know, maybe 30, 40 yards from the car, and we hear a wood knock come from right where the car was. So we did have, you know, company with us there. And and when Sonia came here twice, there was a, you know, some good stuff that happened, you know, both times. She tells the story of how she left this crystal in the woods, at this spot we were tenting it, and she didn't tell me about it. I had no idea. It ended up, when we got back to my place, it was in my bag, you know. And so she was like mind blown, because she knew, you know, I had no idea about that. And I said, oh, here's your crystal, right? And also she's a good eyewitness to tell the stories of when she came down and experienced Neff's family, bluff charge, paranormal activity. She doesn't really get into that, but
And why do the bluff charge? What are they saying when they do that?
He's just messing around.
Oh, okay. Playing.
Yeah. But she described it basically the size of a bull, come running right at us and, kind of pounced at the end. I remember thinking for a second, we're sitting on the road thinking for a second, by being charged at by a bear, right? As a split second, then I realized, okay, no, it's just you guys messing around, right? So there's some really good eyewitness testimony, to support my claims, basically, right, about the activity going on there.
What?
It took her a long time to come forward, but I was glad she finally did. So.
Absolutely. What do they feel about us? What do they think about humans?
I don't really know. I think they love us, probably not all of us, but maybe some of them can't stand humans. I don't know. I asked them one time about, I'd asked some questions about something and said, aren't you over there where it's safe to this certain place and that they mentioned, instead of here, and they wrote here help, basically here to help us. They know what's going on. They know what's going on in this world more than we do. They know we're under attack. They know about all this, these things being stuck in human. They know about all that. They even wrote, they drew that, they drew a needle and wrote humans die sad, with a sad face. They're well aware of everything that's going on. They know about CERN, what they're doing with CERN. They know.
Did they write something about CERN?
I asked a question about it. Basically, are they unleashing evil? They said, yep. And they're using CERN to do that.
That's incredible. So I think, I think what fascinates me is when you see a lot of footage of how many different species there are. Because there appears to be many different kinds.
Well, if you look at humans, look how many there are with humans, right? We're people, they're people. So, they're
Absolutely.
before us. They're before us from what they say. So,
Did
humans come after them.
they ever tell you what it means when they make all of these X's with trees and there? It just seems to be some kind of a sign when you're going through these areas. Like I always feel if there's an X, like maybe you shouldn't go there. I don't know.
I've never really asked them about that. I do believe that some of them are like a soft exposure, them it just piquing our curiosity. Because a lot of them are put right beside trails that humans frequent, right? Like right there beside trails, right in our face. So I think those ones are like a soft exposure. Maybe, other than that, I don't really know. I've had them built around my tent spot on Dwayne's property, where they basically bordered it with a structure, a broken tree. This is Mike's spot. Even weaved elevated structure amongst a bunch of saplings on one side. I remember once there was a blanket, wool blanket, left for them and the gift tree at the time, which was a broken tree, running horizontal. They'd folded the blanket over it like a tent, doing stuff like that. And I pulled in one time, and there's a three-stick structure in my parking spot. I remember that happened too. Chris Munch got invited back in 2015, I think it was, or 13, or I can't remember, but I think there was a three-stick structure when he showed up too, and there was a marble on top of that. So he got to witness some pretty crazy stuff there as well. He saw marbles appear out of thin air. He's the guy who did the film Letters from the Big Man. So yeah, this situation is very, very developed. You know, the trust is there. The activity, like I said, has been 100% of the visit since day one. It's crazy.
Do you
Crazy.
ever, I mean, there's some accounts, and I'm just curious about what they feel about it, where, like humans, you're gonna get good, you're gonna get bad, you're gonna get everything. And there are accounts of some people who've experienced really terrifying things with some species. And there's been deaths. Do they ever communicate anything about those clans or those?
When I hear there's been deaths, it's like, where's the proof? I think there's a lot of disinformation put out there to paint them in a bad way. You know, just like the whole UFO subject, a lot of disinformation put out to paint things in a negative light, you know. I think that's done with this because there's a war on human consciousness, right? And contact with Sasquatch empowers humans and expands human consciousness. And you are uncontrollable. 100%. You can't be controlled by government or whatever, you know, with after you have contact with them. You know, it's just like you are so aware and awake at this point. So there, I see a lot of monster, you know, negative stuff and attacks and, you know, this person ripped apart. It's like, yeah, bullshit. There's no proof. But as far as you know, some things happening where people might call it an attack or something. If it was an attack, you wouldn't be telling the story. And but some things that happen, yeah, they're gonna scare the shit out of people because, you know, when you hear a bus-sized something coming at you in the woods, you know, running right at you know, you're gonna, you know, pee your pants or something, right? It's gonna scare you.
Do you think the government has very little success with regards to hunting them and trying to capture them?
I don't know what technology they have to locate them. I believe they're using lidar technology, you know, but you know, their Neff's family, you know, everything's still fine, right? You know, this is partly why they stay invisible, right? Because they are hunted by military. I asked them that question before. They said yes. You know, they don't want them around. There's people that do not want them. You know, they are the missing link. You know, they're the missing link to our histories of all lies. You know, it's, well,
Absolutely.
everything, there's so much lies told to us. I've asked a lot of conspiracy related questions and saying, okay, that was true, that was true, that was true, that was true. You know,
Yeah, like what?
well, they're manipulating the weather. You know, government, military are causing the tornadoes, the flooding. You know, they're manipulating the weather to harm us. Stuff like that. I asked about the moon landing. You know, they even said, no, never left. Stuff like that. Which is obvious, you know.
It is obvious, yes.
Anybody who believes that still, sorry, you're, you know. It's clearly obvious.
Do you ever worry about the government following and trying to,
I'm watched, they told me. I'm watched by bad humans. I'm watched by good too, they told me. I don't know what. Non-human. I don't know what.
Your guardians.
Don't know. I've asked, do I have spiritual protection? They wrote no. So that was a little weird, but
What? Are you sure that wasn't the trickster?
no, I don't know. Could have been. I never asked, but it could have been.
Seems like something he would do.
Yeah, I could see that.
What do they eat?
I don't know. you know, we've brought gifts. I brought gifts over the years. And, I remember, like Dwayne, he brings pepperoni sometimes, right? Bring a package. And I remember the first time, you know, some disappeared. He asked me, did you eat some of my pepperonis? I said, no. And we found out they were disappearing out of the fridge. And it got to a point where, well, sometimes they would break a piece off, drop it in my beer, you know, stuff like that. And, you know, just being funny, right? It got to a point where there was a brand new package sealed. And I had counted them like three times to make sure he knew how many were in there. And they were still disappearing. And I had brought a package of muffins recently, you know, with the sticker on it at Costco. Mm-hmm. And you can tell when those stickers pulled off and put back on.
Mm-hmm.
If you, no matter how good you try to do it, you can tell, right?
Yeah.
A muffin ended up going missing. They stuck it in my bag and the package hadn't been touched. I had brought a pie once. It hadn't been touched. There was a marble inside it. So they can move inanimate objects through inanimate objects. This is fact. I've witnessed it over and over, right? I remember one time I'm wearing contacts right now. I had a contact big container solution.
Mm-hmm.
And they ended up putting this little toy something, little piece of toy something inside of it. There's like, there's something inside of there. So, you know, I found out the lids on those, you can't pull them off.
Yeah.
They pop out from the inside, which I had to cut the thing open. So it's basically a sealed container. And I realized you got to pop the lid out from inside of it to get that lid out. So they had put something in there. I remember one time we were out after the winter. We're on the road looking for marbles, and I see this rock, you know, this little whatever rock about yay big, and it had this red dot on it. And I took notice of that. And I picked it up, and I put it back in the little divot in the road, and I went from there. Dwayne's up the road, and I went from there into the cottage. I went into my camera bag, and there's the rock that I just had in my hand. You know, so it's constant. I've witnessed so much of this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's normal in my life.
Mm-hmm.
I'm
mm-hmm.
so used to it.
Do they ever talk about God or Jesus? Or do they know? Did you ever ask?
I've asked, is Jesus Christ the Son of God? They wrote, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I asked about the CERN thing. I said, did they use CERN to unleash Satan? They said yes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yep.
I didn't say evil. I actually said Satan.
Yeah.
They're the key to our true history. Getting, mm-hmm. you know, I think.
Yeah.
Learning the real stuff, you know.
What was the most incredible experience that just blew your mind?
Oh, geez, I don't know. It's.
I know there's a lot. I know there's a lot.
It's countless, you know, like it was awesome when I got a, you know, a hug last visit, you know, on my head or when I saw the marble pop through the veil. You know, the first time we heard vocals in the cottage, there's so much. It's just,
mm-hmm.
I don't really have an answer for that. It's just, there's too much. So.
There was an experience that I had with my girlfriend in Mount Shasta, and I was being communicated by a male, large male. I knew it was a Sasquatch, but I couldn't handle seeing them. I've had too many weird things in my life, but I was like, I just need to stabilize. I just terra firma. I don't think I can handle seeing, but I'm happy to communicate. So over the period of 3 nights that we were there, I said, maybe you can send somebody whose energy is a little like softer or younger. They sent the son, who was like a teenager, and he was hilarious. And we communicated over 3 nights, but it was really funny because he wanted to take a piece of the car as a memorabilia, like to remember. So he actually took a piece of the car, but he had left his handprints all around the car every night. And we took photos of it, and you could see, right? Clear as
They were
day.
oily, right?
Yep, and they were just everywhere in the car. Like he wanted to let me know, see, yes, this is confirmation. This is real. I'm here. But the morning that we left, realizing that he had actually taken a piece of the back end of the car fender.
He took the fender.
Like he took this piece of, yeah. I mean, it was a large piece, and I knew, like, it because there was telepathy, and I could just feel him laughing, but it was like he wanted a piece to remember.
So he broke it off.
Yeah, so he broke it off. Yeah, it was, it was, I mean, I had to laugh. Like, I was like, out of everything, I didn't think to leave something, right? I should have, but I didn't. And so he broke it off. Yeah.
What'd you tell the repair guy?
Oh, we couldn't say anything. Like it was just, it's.
I would tell them. I get a kick out of telling people, right? Yeah, Sasquatch took it.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Yeah.
This guy's a
But,
lunatic.
when I had the communication with him, he was telling me that, because I said, why are you communicating with me? There's so many people that come to Mount Shasta. It's just like littered with so many people. And he said, yeah, but they weren't very happy about that. And they weren't very happy how people in general don't respect anything and they have an entitlement. So, yeah, it was, I felt that they were not very happy with the way that we are. When we're out there, we treat everything with a level of disregard. So, yeah.
So when he was communicating with you, it's this full sentences he's given you, and
Yeah, it was very telepathic. It was very,
was it voice?
it was voice, and sometimes it was visual. So it was just like a conversation that was happening. Yeah. And my girlfriend was terrified because we were in a tent and we could hear him, right? We could hear him around and sometimes he would make really loud sounds and walk. So she thought that we were going to die, right? This is like so it
That's
was
no fun.
No, it was so bad one night that she actually was crying, and I think she went into her car. And I kept trying to tell her, no, it's okay. Like, this is him just letting us know it's real. Like, there's nothing that's going to happen. We're fine.
You're
Right?
actually protected, if anything else came around,
That's
they.
what I told her. I said, if anything, yeah, they're gonna protect us. We're okay. But she just was so terrified. So, but yeah, it was conversation. It was telepathic conversation. And I was asking some questions. They were very, I mean, there was a level of concern about the state of like humans, right? Where we're at mentally, emotionally. Like there was a level of concern. You guys got a ways to go here, right? I was kind of curious, like, why are you communicating with me? Like, I don't know how to help, right? Like, just, but what he impressed in some of the telepathy were impressions, and you could feel it, and you could know what he was saying. And some of it was that, yeah, like, they don't communicate to anybody that's out of integrity. They don't pick people out of integrity. Like they pick people that are like honest and they know. They just know, right? And yeah, but that was my Sasquatch experience.
And they don't they don't judge your
No.
past or whatever. I have made all kinds of bad choices in my life. I was
Right.
little shit growing up, you know. I've been in trouble, and
Yeah.
but they don't, you know, they don't judge that way.
No, not at all. There's like no feeling of it at all. I just find it fascinating. Do you think that, I mean, to me, it would appear like they're everywhere in the world.
Yeah. Yeah,
Right?
it sure seems like it.
I know.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I know when you do archaeological research, I know in university when I was in archaeology, there was always the issue of the missing links, right? It can't be explained. I mean, the information you get from university is ridiculous anyway.
Yeah, it's an indoctrination system,
Right.
right? We are, this is what it is. This is what it has to be. In this box, don't you dare step out of that.
So you see these missing links. I mean, anywhere in your questions, did you ever ask them if they were survivors of the flood, of the big cataclysm that happened?
No, I've never asked that.
Yeah.
No.
That might be an
No,
interesting
but
question.
there's definitely a lot of, you know, a lot of evidence on Earth that there were giants so much bigger than them. Just massive, massive giants, right?
Massive
Yeah.
titans.
Yeah, our history's, you know, just, I'm sure they have all the answers tucked away in the Vatican or wherever, you know, a certain amount of people on this earth get to know that, and the rest of us are indoctrinated to a slave system, basically, right?
Yeah. Do they have a hard time in the winter at all?
Yeah, I don't
No.
think so. Yeah.
They don't use fire, right?
Not that I'm aware.
Yeah.
You know, unless, who knows? I don't like to talk about where I think they live in that, but
Yeah.
you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
I remember one gentleman told me a story, and he was what was his name? I think Chuck. He's a firefighter, like a fire chief in four different departments over 40 years, something like that. Very credible, credible guy. He told me that I chat with him once, him and his partner that do this stuff, and he told me, he goes, yeah, I used to listen to you until you got into the paranormal, interdimensional stuff, and then I was like, nope, I shut you off, right? And then it happened to him. And he told me he had an experience once, basically, where they showed him that they don't feel the cold. You know, it was almost like he was put in a bubble of warmth. Yeah, it's they are built for the elements, right? They're built for this earth. We aren't. And
I wonder.
we're the only thing on earth that's the odd thing out.
Yeah,
Everything else
exactly.
is built for the earth.
Yeah, and it seems like they have metaphysical genes that are turned on and activated. So somehow their species managed to be activated metaphysically with their metagenes, yet humans, it's the reverse.
Yeah, we're shut off.
Yeah, exactly.
But we get these little glimpses of things, you know,
Right.
telepathy or, you know, it's I've had, you know, I've had telepathic incidents where I've captured thoughts, and you know, somebody says something and I heard that in my head just before they say it, or you know, stuff like that.
Well, for us, it would be what they say is 99% junk DNA. They want to let you believe that everything is junk DNA, bar except with the exception of a tiny amount,
There's no junk.
right?
I doubt there's any junk
That,
whatsoever. It's all.
exactly. And that's what's turned off. So it would seem like their DNA is just so much more activated. So how did they prove, how in the world were they able to preserve that without being devolved like humans?
Well, they haven't been manipulated. You know, we're entirely manipulated. And we're attacked from birth. You know, that cord is cut too early. They're right there. That's your first attack, basically, right? You're injected. You're I remember back in school as a kid, you know, here, put these mouth guards full of fluoride in your mouth, you know. You know, here, take these injections, and we're attacked. Everything's poison. We're persistently attacked to shut us, keep our. I remember when I was a kid, man, I had some skills going on. It was almost like I could see with my eyes closed, basically. You know, I had these senses that I rarely get to glimpse them anymore. They have come up. The last time I noticed this one that I remember I had as a kid, it was I don't know, maybe a few years back anyways. You know, it's like, oh, there it is. It's funny though, it took a took an argument to bring it out, and I'm sitting there, you know, I've got this person squawking in my ear, and I'm having this feeling, right? And it's almost like everything's enhanced, and it's just weird. It's like everything's magnified, and it's hard to describe, but you know, it's like, that's what, you know, I had that when I was a kid. But
And then
yeah,
suddenly it disappears, right?
well, it gradually
It
over time,
gradually, yeah.
through being poisoned, right, and
Exactly.
indoctrinated, and
What is it about, you said that the umbilical cord gets cut too early. Is that something they told you?
no, I remember I watched this video once, this person, you know, mentioning that, and I thought about it. I thought, yeah, you're right, because you know, that's feeding, you know, that's feeding you as a infant, you know. It's, I think that should be held back until it's completely, whatever, empty, dried up, or whatever, you know,
That makes
happened.
sense.
Yeah.
So,
So
do you think Neff and her family,
him.
they look at you as family?
Yeah, Neff's a male, right? So
Okay. But they look at you like you are a family member.
it, I would say so. You know, they've expressed that they love me and numerous times. And,
Well, Neff has said your name often and
oh
said,
yeah,
I love you.
he actually one time way back in 2015, you know, because of trespassing, there was stuff going on, and situation was being infiltrated, and you know, Dwayne pulled the plug on the visits, right? So that was it. Suddenly, I think at that time I had 9 visits in a row with direct verbal communication with Neff, you know, recorded on audio, and then suddenly it's yanked from under me, and I was devastated. And that visit, they knew what was going on, and that's when they said, "We love you." That's and at the beginning, they actually said, Neff said, "Ninadadwa." And I found out that means invader go. They wrote the English meaning of that.
So it had been infiltrated by people who were trying to like have access to them.
Yeah, or yeah, trying to prove it a hoax or whatever. You know, but these, all these people are that ape mentality. They don't have the experience understanding that they are interdimensional. There's cottages all over there. You know, the neighbors, they don't have a clue what's going on, right? It's, like I said, much of the activity is indoors. So it's very, you know, they can show up and do something, and you could have somebody stand right there and they wouldn't have a clue.
Do you think they're afraid? I mean, to reveal themselves to the world fully? Because, humans are dangerous.
There's a time and a place, right? There's a time for everything. So this is why they waited 3.5 years almost for those pictures to be put out. It's timing. So the way they're revealing, it's on a collective as it is individually. I see how they interact with humans individually, and it's the same as a collective on their exposure, right? So, but yeah, they stay hidden because they're hunted. They're, you know, they know they frighten humans as well, you know, with their appearance.
Is there any indication that they've given you about the future or about where we're going as a species?
Not really, although I think they can see ahead in our timeline, you know, and the fact that they are exposing their existence, I don't think is really a good thing. We're under attack, you know, and everything might seem not so bad right now, but, you know, I think there's some nasty stuff coming down the pipe at some point.
And do you think that's going to be with aliens or entities of some kind?
Well, you know, there's humans that basically worship the dark side, right? And they have their agenda. They're not going to stop. You know, if we even whatever we're catching on, there it doesn't matter. They're not stopping. Until you know we stop them. Basically, I don't know. Maybe they. Who knows where they're at with their technology? I remember seeing one person. I can't remember who it was. You know, very high up individual basically state that, you know, whatever you can dream up, we've already invented it, basically.
And is that why do you think they're coming out more and more? And that's not a good sign because of where we're headed?
Well, also, you know, they're burning the forest down. You know, this is their home. This is the home of the Sasquatch. And the evil is burning it all down, you know? You know, we're under attack. All these fires, that's all, those aren't natural.
No, those aren't natural. Is there any feeling that they give you that they want? I mean, could they come against these forces with their abilities? Are they able to counter this in some way?
I don't know. I don't know. I would think that they could, but maybe. You know, maybe they're so evolved that it's not conducive to their karma, or you know, maybe they just, I don't know. I really don't have the answer for that, but they are, you know, they're highly evolved, right? I say it all the time, the epitome of don't judge a book by its cover. You know, they're so advanced in their consciousness and, you know, understanding of love and you know, they're way past us.
I mean, way. So we come from the Anunnaki, but they don't. That's fascinating. But they never told you who.
No, I haven't. Maybe I just have to ask the right question. I don't know.
Yeah, I find that really fascinating. Do they ever give you any information about other cryptids?
I asked about the dog man once. You know, are they your people? No. Are they good? No. So I was given that.
Do you know if you have any in your neck of the woods there? Are there any accounts?
Accounts of
other cryptids.
Here? Not that I'm aware of.
Not
here. I don't, I really don't have any experience with that. It's funny, I've just been watching this series, Hellier, which is pretty interesting. I think it's a few years old now, maybe about 5 years old, about the goblin stuff in the cave systems, you know, throughout Kentucky. And you know, they did a good job on that. You know, I really have no desire about that stuff. Although I have had a couple incidents with UFOs and contact, at least one contact dream, and then another one that looked like I was being checked out, basically. So the UFO incidents were back in July 2018. They were one in the day, one at night, 15 days apart, pristine conditions both times. So I couldn't dismiss it as something else. And the first one was basically flew right over top of me, but I couldn't see. It was cloaked. It's a cloaked ship. There was zero clouds in the sky. And it was 12:30 in the afternoon. I'm driving past Pearson, going north on the 400. There's probably about 10 lanes there. On my left, I got a transport just ahead of me. I think there was a vehicle behind that. I'm going with the flow of traffic. And suddenly this large shadow passes over top of me, going just a little faster than everything else to stick out. And it enveloped the truck. And this only lasts a few seconds. But right away, I was like, you know, something's not right. Mm-hmm. And I look at, there's nothing there. And I realize that's a cloaked ship, man. That's a freaking UFO. It had to be. There was nothing there.
Yeah.
Nothing to give this moving shadow. So 15 days later, I was up in Neff's area, and I was in my tent spot, and I could see way off in the distance. And I'm by myself, see way off in the distance, this flight path. And watching planes, you know, basically cross this way. And I can see their flashing lights, hear the engines catch up after. And again, crystal clear skies. And then the way those planes were going from the far end where they were headed towards, I see this light pointed at me, like a plane with its headlight pointed right at me. And it was coming towards me. And I remember, you know, almost immediately I noticed there's no flashing lights in this thing. And it was a dead still night too. And so I watched it, and it came closer and closer. It ended up flying. It could have been a couple thousand feet in altitude. It was pretty low.
Wow.
And I didn't see a craft because it was just a big bright light.
Yeah.
It was dead silent, not a sound from this thing. So it wasn't a drone or anything. It was dead silent, or not a drone that, you know, that our technology is aware of. But yeah, so that happened. Then I had a couple of dreams. One with it was like a mothership with all these other smaller craft flying around. And I remember in this dream, this one craft come down, it flew in my ear, and it's like it scanned me, and I had a flash of a gray alien face, and I woke up. So that was really weird. And then I had another one with this, it's like a blonde ET with a third eye, really green piercing third eye. And I remember she put her hand on my forehead and said some words to me. And I broke down in the dream. And then I woke up, you know, once that was over, right?
Yeah.
That was a positive dream. You know, I don't want to say what she said to me, but she said some positive stuff, right? So, you know, there's a connection there. And of course there would be with, you know, anything that is as evolved and telepathic as the Sasquatch. And, you know, I think there's a lot more going on in our existence than, you know, we've been led to believe. And, you know, where these UFOs are coming from, you know, it seems to be interdimensional as well. Right. So where they reside, I don't know. You know, I'm just learning as I go along, and you know, all these experiences, they just bring more questions, right?
So. Right. It seems like when people start having these experiences with Sasquatch, these beings, they end up having a lot of activity that is, you know, other supernatural. It just seems like there's a parallel.
Yeah.
You know, and I do think other beings get really curious. So it's almost like you get on the radar.
Yeah. Yeah, it seems like it.
Mm-hmm. So the experience you had with the blonde, what sounds like a Nordic or some, well.
I don't know. I
was it a healing? Able. Was she healing you?
Was no. There,
no. No, okay.
No, it wasn't me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She said something, and then she said, you have a dream.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so, that's profound.
Basically, you know,
mm-hmm.
I just want to change the world, right?
Well, yeah, I think that's what we're trying to do with this all, to, you know, expand consciousness and evolution so that we can get out of the, you know, primordial soup.
This, you know, this shit show that we're all subject to with, really, you know, it's you say we're under attack, right? You know, our own government is, I don't want to get into that. That guy's got a, he's got to go. And I mean,
If it's a guy, I think it's a creature of, you know, the abyss.
Well, that, that guy in that, yeah, anyway, so.
Yeah, I think we're all in agreement. No.
I can be very negative about that, right? I think they should have just dropped the bomb on Davos, basically, right? Get rid of all them. That's it. You're in there? Sorry. You're gone. Bye.
Yep.
Wipe them all out.
So when are you going to visit with Neff and the family next? Soon?
I never like to tell.
Right. Ever. Yeah.
Because of all that's happened.
Yeah.
You know, and we keep our eyes open. You know, we know there's still people. Still people trying to, you know.
Yeah, gosh. I know. I know.
It's never stopped, you know.
Yeah.
They like to try and discredit, call me a hoaxer, but hey, still 10 years later, you know, still at it.
You're always going to get that garbage. Just, it's just the way it is.
But I love the fact that, you know, the activity is very personal and very confined that, you know, these other people, they get nothing, right?
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter who's around, who's trying to see anything.
Yep.
They know if anybody's there.
I know.
It's going to happen.
Which is brilliant.
The minute they're gone, hey, you know, vocal or whatever.
Well, I'm going to put down, Mike sent me some audios from Neff that I'm going to include at the end of the video here for everyone to hear. It is so amazing to hear the audio of Neff. Okay, I just can't express that when I heard it, it actually made me cry.
I understand.
Yeah.
It has a very profound effect on a lot of people. Makes people cry, laugh.
Yeah. I did both.
It makes people angry. Some people angry. The ones that get nothing, right? They get angry.
Oh, isn't that interesting?
It is interesting.
Yeah. I cried and laughed. It was just so, it was just so powerful. Absolutely can say I love Neff. You can say hi to Neff, right?
Maybe he's listening.
You know, but I'm gonna add that at the end of the video. I think it's such a blessing to hear it. You know, and I think the frequency is so powerful. It just does something to you.
Yeah.
So I want people to experience that. And I think they do. And I think that it opens them up to this in a way that maybe wasn't there before, right?
It also, you know, it helps some people understand that, they're not this animal monster, you know, that's being portrayed about them.
Yeah.
You know, we still get these television shows and still science, like, you know, the anthropologist whose face is on every Sasquatch show still pushing the Gigantopithecus crap, you know, 100% they're not that. And he's still, you know, it's like, I have no respect for him whatsoever.
It's ridiculous.
It's pathetic. And the BFRO, same thing, you know, the whole Matt Moneymaker thing. Still pushing that same crap.
Yep.
They know there's more to it.
Oh, I mean, they're running propaganda.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
For an agenda.
The anthropologist there, I've put stuff in front of him basically, through group email. He knocks everything down, right? Oh, that was wearing shoes. Oh, that's a double print or vocal indoors. Oh, that's ridiculous. It's like, shut up. You don't know anything. He doesn't know anything.
That's it in a nutshell. He doesn't know anything.
No.
But he's running an agenda. He's running some agenda.
He has no experience. I've told people that I've learned more in one night than he has in his entire career, whatever, four decades or however long it is, right?
But you know what's, this is the thing about your work, Mike. It's 100% in integrity.
Yeah.
It's 100%. 100%. You are of integrity, and you can tell by all of the work that you have and that you do, it just is that.
And I think that's, why they keep showing up and giving and giving and giving. And I know I'm speaking out, and to a lot of people, I just look like a lunatic, right? But I'm okay with that. I tell anybody and everybody at this point, I don't care. I'm comfortable with it.
At this point, more and more people who are the skeptics are having experiences, and they're seeing life isn't what they thought it was, and this is all crumbling before their eyes. Okay.
Finally, I'm glad.
I know, right? What is Neff's favorite treat that you give, that you leave her, him at the gifting tree?
At this point, I don't know. It's we used to give them peanut butter cups way back, right? But that hasn't happened in years and years. They don't really touch the food very much, right? So I'm basically bringing magic mushrooms.
That's the favorite food. Yes, okay.
At this point, yeah, I was given a message recently too, basically from Nin Yan, and it's like, hey man, bring some more.
Oh my God, that is so funny. Well, do you want to say anything else before we finish? I've kept you for almost 2 hours, so I don't want to be cruel.
No, it flies by, right? Just that I have my channel Sasquatch Ontario on YouTube, and you can reach me at sasquatchontario@yahoo.ca for Canada. You can reach me on Facebook under Mike Paterson, 1T. Or sasquatchontario.com. I have a website that I don't really keep updated like I should. If anybody wants to get a hold of me, it's all good.
Wonderful. This has been phenomenal, and just a real blessing. Absolutely. I think this information is so critical. I really feel it's critical.
It's
And
coming. It's coming to the forefront, right?
yeah.
When I first got involved in this, nobody was really talking about this Kawoni, but he didn't really have any supporting evidence, just his book that he put out. But I think this really helped kick the door down to the whole interdimensional aspect of them, and a
Yeah.
lot more people, are seeing that
Yeah.
and witnessing that and coming forward and sharing their experiences. And so it's fantastic to see that.
Yeah, and a lot more people are having experiences. It's been, just mind-blowing when you think about, 30 years ago, you didn't hear a lot.
Yeah, like I said, we are basically in the midst of a reveal. They gave me an experience once to show me that. They said, soon your people will know. And they gave me an image with that. It showed me. It's like, okay, they are exposing their existence.
Profound.
That one was, I had just woken up, so I was wide awake. I'm still laying in bed, but I was wide awake when I think it came from their collective. It wasn't from Neff personally, it was from their people.
And what do they call their people? What was the name?
Well, what Neff's family wrote was Mushtaba.
Mushtaba. I love their language and I love their names. Everyone, please go to Mike's YouTube, Sasquatch Ontario, because his work is phenomenal, and you'll be blown away. So
I appreciate that. Thank you very much. And it's a great gift to it was, I've always said, it's meant to be shared, right?
And I thank you so much for this interview and your time.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks everyone for being here, and we'll catch you later.
guys are amazing.
Yo!
Neff! My friend! Yo!
Yo!
Oh, my friend, it's been a long time. Love you, buddy. Nyeta who? You're a good man. Can you say that again? Can you speak up, my friend? Can you be louder? Oh, it's good to hear your voice, Neff.
Four.